We put together a record, DC Talk, and no record deal yet. Sent it to Nashville. A little company called Forefront liked it. They signed us. We all left college. The rest is history.
High school was very mixed, white, black, Asian, Hispanic. The school slogan of my junior high was, "We're black, you're black, we're all black at Luther Jack."
There's probably nobody else in our industry as talented probably as Tony.
I truly believe I see the hand of God on Toby Mac's life.
Kevin Michael McKeon, professionally known as Toby Mac, grew up in the Northern Virginia suburb surrounding Washington, D.C. The second of four children, much of Toby's early life revolved around sports.
Fairly normal upbringing, you know, we loved sports. Both of my sisters played basketball, volleyball, all that. My brother and I, you know, from the time we were 7 years old, played football, basketball, and baseball.
At age 12, Toby took up golf and became a champion junior golfer. With so many sports in his life, he had little interest in church.
My mother would just drag us to church on Sunday mornings. My dad was not a believer. He wouldn't go. We didn't really go to Sunday school much. I didn't really understand all that was going on there. I felt like there was a guy behind this box, you know, that was sort of yelling at us, and I would just sit there and draw, write notes. And then this guy invites us to this camp.
13-year-old Toby was lured to church camp by a youth pastor who described it as something like a basketball camp. Toby not only signed up, but invited a few friends as well.
You know, we roll out the van and they usher us into this outdoor pavilion, and this guy gets up there and starts like preaching at us for like an hour. I think we still didn't even get our bags to our room. And my boys were looking at me like, yo, this is the strangest basketball camp I've ever been to in my life. But the guy that invited us, each night, we would sit around in our little cabin, just on the floor, you know, we'd sit there, sort of Indian style in a circle, and he would open up the Bible and share in a very conversational way, and he would dialogue with us, ask us questions about our lives, and then he would tell us about what he had been through, and, you know, that it all of a sudden, it opened my world to God. My heart began to open because I felt like this was I'd never heard it this way before.
On the last night of camp, Toby could no longer contain his desire.
I woke up that youth pastor and I said, look, you know, I really want to do something about what I feel in my heart. I want to pray. I want to, whatever I have to do. He goes, you know, do you want to accept Christ into your life? I said, yes. Then I went back home, got baptized, and I asked my dad to come, and he did. And then a few months later, he accepted Christ. So that's why I'll always honor and partner with youth pastors out there, youth leaders.
Although a turning point in his life, Toby's church camp conversion did little to diminish his hearty teenage appetite for the rock music that was so popular among his peers. But it was another sound, the emerging music of the inner city, that began to stir something within Toby's soul. Downtown DC was a hotbed of emerging hip-hop talent like Curtis Blow, Trouble Funk, and EU. And in the late 70s and early 80s, Douglas Record Shop was their high temple of praise.
The reason we went to Douglas Records is because we couldn't get hip-hop records in the suburbs. I would drive all over to see rap concerts. I would drive to Baltimore when I was 16, 17. And literally, and I know people say this all the time, but literally be the only white boy in the place. My friends and I, we just were there because the music's great, and if we figure we love it and everyone else in there loved it, we were gonna have a good time.
For Toby, there was no shortage of good times during his teenage years. Although heavily involved in school sports and musical groups, he still managed to make time for other pursuits.
Toby's not gonna like this, but the big thing we used to give Toby a hard time on is Toby probably went to, this may be an exaggeration, but not by much. He probably went to 20 proms, maybe 20 to 25 proms.
I went to a lot of proms. And I mean, I was probably 23 and still going to proms.
And so, yeah, so he was popular with the ladies, man.
They were my good friends. And they would just be, I don't have a boyfriend right now. I don't have a prom date. Will you come with me? I'm like, yeah, let's do it.
I think girls of that age even respect him because they knew what he stood for as well.
It was a good time, what can I say?
Toby finished out his high school days and by 1984 had enrolled at Liberty University in Lynchburg, Virginia. It was there that he heard a student sing in chapel, a traditional gospel singer who would change Toby's life forever.
This dude gets up there and just starts killing this spiritual. And it was Michael Tate.
When I first met Toby McKeon, the white rapper, in 1984.
When I met Michael, we immediately became best friends.
But he was like my first really true white best friend I've had to, draw it on.
I remember walking, I forget the street it was called, at Liberty University, walking down by dorm 23 and seeing this guy dressed like Michael Jackson. We were just seeing a white boy from the suburbs. He gets out of his little car, he has a little two-tone, brown and tannish. Looks like a golfer. Little white Kirk Cameron kind of guy, but a Jackson fan, Michael Jackson fan, gets out and shakes my hand and tells me how great of a singer I am, and he enjoyed being in chapel and stuff.
The thickness and the tone that he had and that sort of slightly frosty, we call it frosty, most people call it raspy, just blew my mind.
And so we became fast friends, man.
I mean, literally.
We couldn't get in the same room for the first semester and about killing us, so when we finally got in the same room, we actually took our bunks off of their little, stands and put them down next to each other so we could sleep beside each other. So we wanted just to, be pals and just know that, okay, my buddy's asleep and everything's cool,
There was something that just clicked.
Just like brothers, he's right about that. We were like brothers in college.
Probably the most intense relationship until my wife that I've ever had.
As their friendship developed, Michael began to bring Toby along to his weekend church gigs, where Toby would run sound and handle merchandise. Always a quick study, Toby began to see a pattern developing among Michael's young audiences.
Toby started coming with me on the weekends when I do Michael Tate solo stuff. And he kind of caught a vision like, wait a minute, Michael's singing this a lot of the older crowd. What if we did something for the younger crowd?
They'd see this really cool black dude walk in, and I saw the youth sort of sit up like something was about to rock.
But it wasn't going to happen. Because we weren't going to be invited to the church again. We're going to get that love offering. And we didn't do, what the people wanted to hear at the time.
And he'd get up there and be like, the Lord liveth and blessed be. And I'd be like, man, something's wrong, man. We need to do something to these kids. So I started writing these songs based on touring with Michael.
We felt like the youth weren't getting much. They were getting the Sunday morning service and the Sunday night show kind of thing. But it was kind of geared towards the parents, bringing their kids and stuff, but more for the parents. And so that's where his vision started and his will started turning.
I always thought, why should rap just be rap all the way through? Why don't you rap a verse and have a melodic chorus that hooks people? And that's when I began to sort of develop the songwriting where I'd write melodies and I'd write a rap verse. And I said, Tate, come in here and sing this chorus for me and I'll rap the verse. It just worked.
And it was interesting to me. I was like, man, this is so much better, so much more fun, because it's what my heart, I didn't realize, but my heart was in that, you know?
By the end of summer, Toby and Michael had worked out a way to sneak their new Christian hip-hop into Michael's Sunday night performances. Towards the end of Michael's traditional music, he'd innocently introduced Toby, who by now had adopted the rap moniker DC Talk.
So toward the end of the summer, we had a couple of my songs recorded that Michael sang with me on. And it literally worked the same way every Sunday night. Tate would be up there singing, you know, singing his conservative songs. And then he'd look over and say, well, my friend Toby's down here, and he has this other style of music that he does, but it's more for youth. And everyone's like, oh, well. And he's like, I mean, we couldn't do it here. And everyone would be like, I mean, unless the pastor said we could.
You know, if the pastor would allow this to happen, you know, I'd kind of go like this, and go, come on, Pastor Joe, or whatever, you know.
And then every Sunday night, it would turn into this, where we did a bunch of DC Talk songs.
We sucked them in every time. It's terrible.
Toby's music immediately connected with the youth. The over 30 crowd might have been shocked, but the kids got it.
So that's sort of how we began to realize that this could really work. I mean, these people are connecting with this. It's got a niche.
But it was another fateful Liberty Chapel service that brought their dreams into focus. A dynamic performance by a student from Michigan named Kevin Mack Smith.
We go to freshman chapel, lowered ourselves, you know. We're like juniors and sophomores, but we went to freshman chapel and skipped ours to hear Kevin sing.
Kevin was singing a Brian Duncan song. All my life, I waited for something and not a dog. I forgot the melody. But we were like, man, what a good singer, you know?
I'll never forget that moment either. Those guys are, you know, to this day, I think they're, you know, the two greatest vocalists I've ever been around.
Encouraged by the strength of his friend's vocal abilities, Toby went about developing and recording his own innovative style of music, enlisting Michael and Kevin as background singers. The new group was dubbed DC Talk and the One Way Crew. Toby was DC Talk, Michael and Kevin, the One Way Crew. Soon, the entrepreneurial Toby set his sights on a campus-style distribution deal.
I called my uncle, who actually, my dad's brother, who lived in L.A. and worked at Capitol Records. And he was, like, in the programming side of it. And I said, look, Uncle Billy, can you connect me with someone that can manufacture? And he connected me, and I got a really good rate. So I ran off 1,000 cassettes.
1,000? You crazy? 1,000? He goes, dude, we got to think bigger than, you know. We did 1,000, man. I was shaking in my boots.
I think, it must have been maybe, I want to say 30 days, but I think it was about 45 days, 1,000 cassettes gone.
Before long, Liberty's campus was buzzing with the music of DC Talk and the One Way Crew, a buzz that eventually spread to the Nashville-based Christian music industry. As news of a potential record deal began to surface, Toby became distracted by a beautiful young Jamaican student from nearby Hollins College, Amanda Levy. Introduced by a mutual friend, Toby had been forewarned that he would fall in love with her the moment he saw her.
Our same friend told me the same thing. She was like, you're gonna fall in love with this guy. I know you are.
We opened the door and, you know, it must have been 15 rooms down. I see this girl at the end of the hall look over, and Nicole's like, Amanda.
There he was at the end of the hall in his black sweatshirt and his jeans.
Literally, I was like, she's right. I'm gonna fall in love with this girl.
I look back and I didn't really know, but there was just this physical reaction to his name and him.
Fell in love with everything about her immediately. She was 17 and I was 24.
I knew by the way he treated Amanda and the way he talked and spoke about her that she was the one.
Despite the feeling of destiny between the two, when Amanda learned of Toby's dreams, she definitely had second thoughts.
I was all into him because I thought he was going to be like a businessman and like really be serious about work.
You know, she would said she'd all be embarrassed because she'd go back and tell her friends that she was dating a rapper. And it was just for a family like hers, it just, you know, that just didn't work. And I remember going to her and telling her that, Amanda, I'm going to sign a record deal, I'm gonna move to Nashville and pursue this thing for a few years and see what happens.
I was like, well, bye-bye, because I'm not gonna be married to a musician.
And I was devastated. I started begging. I'm like, look, this is not going to end. This is too good. I do not want this to end. So she stuck with me.
Having persuaded Amanda to continue the relationship while he pursued his musical dreams, Toby made plans to move the group to Nashville and finalize the record deal. In the meantime, though, Michael Tate got an offer from gospel music icon Bill Gaither he felt he couldn't refuse.
Tate was sort of in this limbo land where he was trying to decide if he was going to go with Gaither or DC Talk.
Bill Gaither, you know, called, Mike, I'd like to sing with the group. And I was like, I'm only going to do this, Bill, you know. I have this other band back in Nashville.
And I remember the day he told us that if he got the Gaither gig, he was going to take it.
We had nothing, but, you know, Gaither was this huge industry, you know, and I'm thinking, Bill Gaither or DC Talk, who's DC Nothing at the time.
And I remember Kev and I meeting at Chick-fil-A that day and having this discussion. I remember it like it was yesterday, like, so Kev, what, I mean, do you want to go on with this thing with just the two of us? And he said, yeah, I think so. And I said, I think I do too. So we decided right there that we were going to go on whether Tate got it or not. Well, Tate gets a call like a few weeks later, and Bill went with Mark Lowry. So Tate came back, put his tail between his legs and said, I want to go. I'm like, come on, baby.
And thank God I never got it, because I'd have never, this group would have never been. It might have been, but I kind of doubt it would have been.
In December of 1988, the group signed with 4Front, moved to Nashville, and dropped One Way Crew to officially become DC Talk.
It's a love from above, not of this world. It's kind of profound, a truthful sound, and all God's children are heaven bound. Hit it.
They immediately hit the road playing for large crowds, opening for Christian rock band DeGarmo and Key. Everyone held their breath to see how America would respond to Toby's vision of Christian hip-hop.
We started doing these shows, man, and we started rocking it pretty good. And the crowd went berserk.
I mean, it was amazing because this was a new group and the place just went crazy. And they chanted DC Talk throughout the rest of the night, even when other bands were playing.
And the same thing happened at Creation Festival. They got to come out and do about 2 songs ahead of DeGarmo and Key's set. And that's a huge festival, even back in 89, would have been 60, 70,000 people. When they got done, the crowd didn't want to let them off stage. I mean, they were turning lights on to try to squelch it. And at the end of the day, the crowd wanted more.
The crowd's call for more of DC Talk was answered with the release of DC Talk in 1989 and New Thing in 1991.
Peace in your heart, a new start. Peace in your heart, a new start.
America was falling in love with DC Talk. Amanda Levy, however, was not. Having joined the Jamaican equestrian team and training in England, Amanda had distanced herself from Toby's rock star lifestyle. Now into its third year, the long-distance love affair between Amanda and Toby was failing.
So here I was on the Michael W. Smith tour. It was the Change Your World tour. And I'm just running around with Michael and Kevin like crazy. I mean, we're doing 70 cities, you know, in like 100 days. So I'm just running like crazy. She's in England, 6-hour time difference. I'm trying to get her on the phone. I don't even think I had a cell phone. Then I'm running. I remember being on pay phones, trying to call, and kids are standing there in line for autographs.
You know, I still didn't have a lot of respect for the whole thing. You know, I still hadn't really submitted to the fact that this was my destiny and that I was really, so I didn't really have much sympathy with his shenanigans of, oh, I'm calling you from a payphone. I was like, well, if you weren't on the road, you wouldn't be calling me from a payphone.
It was just trying to stay together then it was the hardest thing I've ever done in my life. And finally, she broke it off.
I loved him, but I just was done being hurt by him and done being kind of put on the back burner, and I'd moved on. I'm gone.
Haven't you heard?
Toby McKeon's career with DC Talk was taking off by 1992. His special vision for Christian hip-hop music had captured a rapidly expanding segment of youth culture, but a grueling touring schedule had caused a rift to open up between he and Amanda Levy, the woman he wanted to marry. When she broke off the relationship, he was devastated.
She had broken up with me for like 3 weeks, and it was killing me. Here I was doing shows. Everything was going great professionally, But I had this big hole in my heart because I thought she was the one, you know? I knew she was the one.
Oh my gosh. All his friends will so attest to this is the man wore me out. I was like, okay, I'm done with this relationship. I'm done. And then he became really interested. And then he's like, oh no, you're the woman I want to marry. I was like, really? Really? Now you've decided that?
I woke Joe up at 4 a.m. and I said, Joey, I'm driving to Atlanta and I'm taking Air Jamaica to Kingston and I'm just going to beg Amanda. He's like, does she know you're coming? I said, no. He goes, all right, buddy, go for it, man.
A desperate Toby landed in Kingston, uncertain of his next step. In the meantime, a 70-city DC talk tour came to a screeching halt.
I just remember the call and everything had to be canceled.
Moving dates or moving rehearsals or moving studio time at a time like that is always tense.
Oh, of course it was tense because you're thinking to myself, okay, where is our leader gone?
He's heading down there and we don't know when he's getting back. That was kind of the, you know, keep us posted.
Went unannounced and called her cousin and asked her if she could pick me up at the airport. So I went to her cousin's house.
And he calls me, you want to go out to dinner? I was like, no. He's like, I'm like, what do you mean you want to go out to dinner? And he says, well, I'm here. Let me take you out to dinner. I was like, oh no.
She's like, what are you doing at my cousin's? Are you crazy? I'm coming over to get you right now.
I went up there and he's like pours his heart out to me. And honestly, I don't know what was wrong with me, but honestly, I was like, there wasn't even any. I was just like, are you kidding me? You should have done this a month ago, 2 months ago. I'm done, you know?
She would not give in, man. I was in trouble. I was on the ropes. And I just stayed at her house for like 2 weeks.
He comes and stays in my house, awkward as can be. And I'm like, I don't even want him here.
As a member of the Jamaican equestrian team in training for the upcoming Pan Am Games, Amanda had little time for Toby. So Toby made himself comfortable in the Levy household and prepared to wait her out.
She'd wake up every morning at like 5 and go to ride all day. All I would see her is at dinner.
And he'd be like sitting at our dinner table and he's like making conversation with me, everybody but me.
And I just would hang out with her family, which was, I know how to be so awkward for them.
But eventually I started like warming up to him. He just was this presence. It's not like he talked to me. He just was just this presence here. I'm just gonna stay.
I don't even know what I was doing, but I thought she was the one and I was just praying to God and seeking him and, you know, trying to make the best impression I could in a short time.
And that's when my parents fell in love with him, was when they realized, oh my goodness, he loves her.
As my mom would say, and I told him before this years ago, don't marry the one you can live with, marry the one you can't live without. And he realized that moment, that's the one I can't live without.
A despondent Toby finally got a glimmer of hope when Amanda invited him to see her ride in the Pan Am Games in Chatsworth, Georgia later that year. Encouraged, he returned to the States and rejoined the tour, determined to make the games and win Amanda over once and for all. Unfortunately, he forgot to relay that information to DC Talk's management.
He won't say this, but I know it's true. He didn't give them the dates, so he had a show then. And I was like, fine, go have your show. You've known about this for a year. If you can't be there, this is my thing. If you can't be there, that's fine.
We were like in like Oregon, like Wenatchee, Washington, and I flew from there into Atlanta, drove to Chatsworth. I was there for 6 hours.
To his glory, he made it. And that's when I really softened to him.
But the spark began to ignite there.
So that was a really big moment for us, for both of us. For me especially, it was definitely when I was like, yeah, I want this man, I want this.
Then she invited me to Jamaica for Christmas, and that's when we got engaged.
With his new bride, Amanda, at his side, Toby jumped back into the touring machine of DC Talk, now headlining for the first time. Their third CD, Free At Last, bore witness to each member finding his place in the group. Michael's silky R&B style, Kevin's soaring vocal power, and Toby's streetwise raps merged into a stage show that was unlike anything Christian music had ever seen. In 1994, DC Talk's connection with youth culture caught the eye of Dr. Billy Graham. In a bold move, he initiated the first youth night with Michael W. Smith and DC Talk. But to many of Dr. Graham's supporters, rock music, especially hip-hop, was the devil's music.
Going in, everybody wasn't quite sure what to expect.
We didn't know if it was going to be the first or last time we ever did youth night for Billy.
Ruth Graham said, "Boys, you guys stock the pond so Billy can go fishing." That was so sweet. We were like, no, Billy don't need us to stock anybody's pond. He's great all on his own.
This was kind of a risky deal, and you could feel that.
Billy said, you know, I'm going to get the guys' words. I'm going to get their the music, understand the music. He goes, they are a little wild at times. He goes, it's the same message delivered in a different way.
He said, when I go to a foreign country, I have an interpreter that interprets what I'm saying, and DC Talk is my interpreter to this generation.
But it was just really, really powerful, and they did a great job, and the kids were into it, and everybody's jumping up and down, and I mean, there's a lot of kids in there.
At the end of the night, we sat there on stage as literally thousands of people filled the infield of the stadium, giving their lives to God.
I'll never forget bending over and looking at Toby, and I'm crying, but looking at his eye. I'll never forget it. I can just see the expression at this very moment that it would be a day that we would never, ever forget for the rest of our lives.
And to think that God could use our songs, our performance, as part of that night is something that will always amaze us.
As the Free at Last tour rolled across America, the band began to crank up the volume on their message of diversity, a message that had started to become their musical battle cry. DC Talk's unparalleled music and message did not go unnoticed. As awards started pouring in, the entire industry knew that DC Talk was poised to cross over into mainstream music.
Mainstream was very interested. They were coming from all different sides wanting to sign DC Talk to mainstream deals.
I knew it was going to go into the mainstream, I promise you. And I knew we were already on Leno, we were on Arsenio Hall, invited to Leno a second time, Arsenio Hall a second time. The gates were opening.
However, the conventional wisdom was that to cross over, Christian X needed to soften the message and the lyrics. Outsiders urged DC Talk to pull back on their next record.
There were many conversations about watering down the message, but they were short conversations. They usually came from an outside influence.
It was a time when Christian music was trying to find its identity, and music, lyrics in particular, were becoming rather subtle.
There was a concern about the message, but that's one thing. Toby never really blinked on that.
Toby started saying from the stage, you know, when and if we do crossover, we're gonna take the crossover with us.
I'll just never forget going out of Florida and writing this song. I wrote the, what will people think when they hear that I'm a Jesus freak? What will people do when they find it is true? I don't really care if they live, because there ain't no disguising the truth.
It was so defiant. We're Jesus freaks. We're ardent enthusiasts about our faith.
It was a stake in the ground that said, this is what I'm about, this is who I am, this is what my life is based on.
You know, if you'd have told me a song like that would be Song of the Year, I would have just never have believed it.
Much props and respect to GMA for stretching and reaching out to the youth culture.
The 1995 release of Jesus Freak, the song soon became DC Talk's anthem and firmly established their claim to mainstream success. Earning DC Talk a Grammy, numerous Dove Awards, and double platinum sales, the album that would forever change the face of Christian music had clearly answered the call to tone down the message. And the answer was a defiant no.
That album had a profound impact on the Christian culture. I don't know if we can even really speak to what impact it had with kids.
I think probably the greatest record ever put out in contemporary Christian music. I mean, it was a landmark recording and remains a landmark recording to this day.
Every day I have a kid come into our office and saying he wants a job at GoTee because of Jesus Freak, or I have an artist that says they want to be on GoTee because of Jesus Freak. I mean, I'm talking every day. Every day.
Just Between You and Me, another single from the Jesus Freak album, ultimately hit the American Top 40, pop music's benchmark of success. Just between you and me, I've got something to say.
I wanna get it straight. I'll never forget, I was driving to church on Sunday morning. I heard Casey Kasem and Rick Dees announce that we were like number 13 or something, and Tate called me, and we were like freaking out.
This week, they're back with their first hit. Top 40, Just Between You and Me. I'm Casey Kasem. You know, I was like, yeah, say it again, Casey. Just between you and me, I've got something to say.
Wanna get it straight before the sun goes down. By 1996, DC Talk was experiencing unprecedented mainstream success without watering down their message. But while the walls between Christian and pop music were beginning to crumble, the walls of racism were still standing tall. A chance encounter on an airplane served as a stark reminder that there was still work to do for DC Talk and plenty of people who needed to hear their message of racial equality.
Michael and I were laughing on a plane the entire trip, just cracking up. And we were just being silly. And we got up and Michael grabbed his bag and started walking forward. And I was getting my bag and a guy grabbed my wrist. And he looked at me right in the eye and said, "Nigger lover." And I just kind of took my thing, I mean, he's a big dude, and I just said, "Man, that's my best friend." It just made me want to flex that muscle of, we are beautiful together, you're wrong.
One of the great things I ever learned was from my dad, and that was how to truly love people for who they are, and not, you know, what they have, or if they're famous, or if they're this color or that color, but to learn about people and learn to love the character in people.
Growing up in the South, it was tough. My granddad was killed by the Klan. We never got bitter. We were just taught to love people and get along.
Every day, there would be people coming in and out of our house that we didn't quite know. My mom was kind of like sketchy on some of the people that were coming in and out, but my dad had such a heart for people. He'd always bring someone home.
Just think, all these different nationalities, that's God's bouquet.
His favorite statement was always, how do you say it? Oh, this race stuff is for the birds. This hate stuff is for the birds.
This hate stuff is for the birds. It's not for human beings.
My father's passed on now to heaven. He's in heaven. But he couldn't wait to meet a person of color, of a different color, of a different nationality, because he couldn't wait to find out what made them tick.
My grandmother would say, "You still hang around that color, boy." And I'm like, "What color is he, Grandma?" You know what I mean? It's like, I kind of decidedly wanted to redefine color people. Epidermis is showing, sir. I couldn't help but note your shade of melanin. I tip my hat to the colorful arrangement, cause I see the beauty in the tones of our skin. How boring would a bouquet be if it was all one color? The beauty is found in the diversity.
Examples of people that hate us because we're hanging around with each other.
I mean, I can remember, like, my friend is telling me stories like, you know, those white guys are going to leave you in the end, Toby and Kevin.
And they resent him for it.
You waste your time, man. You know, you should mess around with that, because that's the mentality they were incubated in growing up.
Actually, Michael gets offended quite a bit.
A lot of people still always tell me, "Tate, you know, you're a black guy. You know, you should eat, love fried chicken, eat watermelon in the summertime, and play basketball."
This is kind of funny, but he gets very offended because everybody thinks his name is Toby.
And also, everyone thinks he's a guy that does the rap side of things.
Well, I don't eat much fried chicken because I like the look thin. Watermelon and melon, period, pretty much bores me. And basketball, never been good at it.
They're basically stereotyping. I totally understand why he gets upset.
What I do like is, you know, rock and roll, snowboarding. I see a lot of black people in the, you know, snowboarding. And I like to rock climb. And people say, well, you're not really black. I'm like, well, why am I really? I mean, being black doesn't mean I have to be, you know, I'm limited to a stereotype that some guy made up of what a black person should be. So that's always bugged me. And I think sometimes I rebel against that. So I try to do things just completely different. I actually go to the beach. I can remember one particular time going to Chattanooga to rock climb. Stop at a little convenience store to get some water and some treats and little things to eat on the road. Go inside, not knowing that my world was about to be rocked like never before. As I walk in, I hear the guy go, "Must be out of towners." I thought, "Must be out of towners? What's he talking about?" I go, "Cool, well, we're out of towners. We are out of towners." And the guy goes, "Boy, where you from?" And I look down, I go, I'm all, you know, I'm Mr. Candid. I talk to a tree. I thought he was talking to me. I go, I'm from D.C. He goes, "Well, you know, you don't belong in these parts." I go, "Excuse me?" He goes, "You don't belong in these parts." I go, "As in, what, here, Tennessee?" He goes, "Yeah." He looked at me, he's like, "Yeah." I was like, "Well, you know, buddy, it's a free country. I mean, I can go anywhere I want to." I said, "We're sending men to the moon every day on a daily basis. You're talking about this racist crap? What are you talking about? I don't belong here." And he goes, "Boy," he said, "we'll hang you around here." He says, "It's getting dark outside. See how it's getting dark? We'll hang you." And here I am, a young black guy, doing well, you know, a few grams, a few platinum records, you know, I'm feeling good about myself, plenty of self-esteem, white friends, black friends, good mom and dad. And for one split second, that one moment in time, never happened before, 30 years old, that one moment, I felt less than human.
The preacher shuns his brother, cause his brother's different color.
I mean, there are kids right now in the inner cities that are absolutely being told, "Don't trust Whitey."
Love that he's been the preacher.
And then there are white kids in the suburbs that are being taught to, you know, walk away when you see a black guy. Fear them.
Like an angel in the wing.
We actually think being in our comfort zones and acknowledging the white man or the black man and just kind of waving across the street to our neighbor makes it just okay. I don't think that it's really the color of skin that people are fighting against or for or over. I mean, look at Ireland. It's religion.
That's where you raise every hill and moon hill of Mississippi.
We've always said from the beginning, we don't really have to say too much about racial integration.
The best thing about meeting Toby and meeting Kevin was the fact that I had in my life two examples, two firm examples that living integration, if you will, can work.
And perhaps no song better reflected DC Talk's ongoing commitment to diversity than Colored People, yet another hit from the landmark Jesus Freak album.
Great song, great concept. It is so, who we are as a human race, but it also puts the message out to people in almost a very tangible, unoffensive way that, hey man, we're all colored people.
Just a day in the shoes of a colorblind man should make it easy for you to see that we just got to want to cover our bones as a part of our anatomy.
Say not to go into business with friends.
Living together with anybody, a wife, brothers and sisters, any intimate relationship is difficult.
As business moved in and we began to sell records and book shows and move to Nashville, suddenly I'm in a leadership position and my best friend is, you know what I mean? It just got weird.
it's like, whoa, hold on. How come you're the leader now? When, you know, we first started college, we were just little guys going to the cafeteria to eat lunch together, and all of a sudden you're telling me what to do. That was tough. It's like, well, why not me, you know? Spiritual. I would buck something he would say, I'd be like, well, no, I wanted this real that way.
What they call me is the, what is it?
The, I call Toby our unofficial leader because he's reluctantly the leader.
Unofficial leader. Toby's our unofficial leader. I'm like, what does that mean?
And at different times, I'm so mean. I'm mean-spirited because different times I would just buck him just to buck him. Just because I was like, okay, I'm going to make his life miserable with that. Nope, I don't want to do that. I say that car's green. You call it purple, I call it green.
I've mishandled it sometimes. I've been too harsh.
It's people coming together with their different agendas, two worlds colliding, so to speak. And this person wants pasta, and this person wants fish.
It made Michael and I not quite as enamored with him. Two rules that we've always lived by. No matter how much of an argument we get in, or no matter how much of a fight we get in, we make things right before we go to bed at night. The other one is that we won't take the stage.
I can't sit here and lie, and I would not want to lie to people listening to me talk right now, but we have broken our golden rule. I have broken them. I've gone on stage mad at Toby before, or mad at Kevin before, or mad at Toby Kevin before. You know, or gone on stage fine, and then in the middle of the show, I'm just like, I can't believe you. Back then, I'm like on stage singing away, you know? That's human life. I'm unjustified. I felt bad for it. I've confessed it, but that's real life. And there have been nights I've gone to bed on the bus thinking, you know what? I'm not going to confess this because he's a jerk.
Bristol, Tennessee. Supernatural tour. We were backstage, and I don't even remember what the issue was.
You're just tired. The tour was going long and worn out. And
we got in a heated argument, and we were supposed to go on like 2 minutes. And this is right after Bible study. Well, obviously, it ran right into the show. I mean, and they were holding the show up.
I forgot what I said to Kevin. Somehow I ruffled his feathers pretty bad. He was like, you know what, Tate? You know, dude, you can do the show yourself. And I go, okay, I'll do that. You know, thinking I'm going to call the guy's bluff.
So he walks out.
I thought, surely he's going to come back out of here. And so once again, my pride got up and I thought, okay, I'm not going to go out there and talk to him. Forget it. So I'm just going to see what happens here.
So Mike and I took the stage.
We hopped into the first song. And I think, surely he's gonna show up. Keep thinking the show's gonna go on without it.
We did the first song. And on the second song, Kevin walks up behind me, just like puts his arm around me, and Mike looked over at him and gave him a smile.
Right away, I thought, I'm glad he's out there. I'm gonna have a better show now because he's out there. So the show went on. I knew at that very moment that I had to deal with this issue, but I couldn't do it the right then because I'm singing a song. So when we got to the song Between You and Me, it was really strange because every night Toby and Kevin come together at the very end of the song. I thought for sure Kevin was just gonna stay over there and blow me off. And so he comes over, my arm around me, he puts his arm around me, and right there, without even words even being spoken, I knew at that very moment that that was a moment of recompense, a moment of reconciliation. Sorrow is a
lonely feeling. And although that was not exactly the normal way we reconcile our differences, we did right there.
And of course, we dealt with it officially after the show, but it felt so good to know that I could do that and not even say a word. Like almost like a husband and wife, intimate relationship. And you know what that person's feeling in that very moment.
Between you
and Me is about reconciling our differences. Ironically, that's the song that went to the top 15 on top 40 radio. And it's just like constantly in our face. A reminder of you guys made it an agreement. Forget the songs. Forget the shows of 15, 20,000 people. Forget any amount of gold records or Grammy awards. The fact that we've stayed together for 12 years and reconciled and reconciled and reconciled and reconciled is the most impressive thing. I mean, in my heart.
I have to accredit Toby and Kevin with teaching me things about myself that I didn't know.
Learning to listen and learning to see their needs and try to meet them and learning to wash their feet has been great for me. It really has, because it's not who I was when I started DC Talk. Just don't ever say it can't work, because it can work.
I don't think there's a doubt about it. One of my favorite DC Talk memories would have to be the Billy Graham concert, Crusade, Billy Graham and DC Talk at a sold out Cleveland stadium.
To not only one of our heroes, but a man that believes in you. Come on. You see, Billy Graham.
Billy got to speak that night, and he spoke using one of our songs called The Hard Way that Toby penned the lyric to. And as that man spoke the gospel, preached a very simple message, he infused our lyrics, Toby's lyrics, in that message. And I watched the people get rocked. Toby and I sat back, tears coming down our faces. Couldn't believe how powerful it was. You know, Billy's just a man, but just the fact of being connected with the ministry like that, on that kind of level, and then using our words to facilitate a message to the people. Nothing better. Great memory.